Isaac heard Jacob entering the room.
"Who is it?"
he asked.
"Esau, your firstborn," lied Jacob.
"I have done as you told me, father. Set up and taste this good food and give me the blessing."
Sold for a bowl of stew. The memory verse is from Romans chapter 12, verse 10. It says, "Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves." Today's message is, I can love people who are different from me. Imagine that you have been playing outside all day. Maybe you were playing with friends or helping in the garden. You come into the house and smell something really good. Someone is cooking in the kitchen, and all of a sudden you are very hungry. That's just how Esau felt one day. Let's find out what happened. Isaac and Rebecca had been happily married for years. Rebecca loved to remember the day she had met the stranger at the well. She had offered to water his camels, and her life had changed forever. Isaac praised the Lord for bringing her to him from so far away. Yes, Isaac and Rebecca loved each other very much. But something was missing in their lives. Rebecca was not able to have children, and it made her very sad. Isaac knew about God's promise to Abraham, his father. God had told Abraham that his family would become a mighty nation. Isaac spent a great deal of time wondering how that could be. How could a mighty nation come from Abraham's family? Isaac didn't have any children. It was a sad puzzle, one that Isaac longed to solve. Finally, Isaac pleaded with God. He begged God to give Rebecca a child, and God answered Isaac's prayer in a surprising way. Rebecca had not one child, but two. God gave Isaac and Rebecca twin boys. Even before the twins were born, they struggled together inside their mother. Rebecca thought this was strange. No one could explain why this was happening. Her husband couldn't. Her nurse couldn't. Neither could anyone else she asked. So Rebecca talked to God. She prayed and asked God what was happening. God answered Rebecca's prayer. He told her that the two children inside of her were very different. They would be the beginnings of two different nations. Two nations that wouldn't like each other very much. One twin would be stronger than his brother, and the elder would serve the younger. Isaac and Rebecca named their twins Esau and Jacob, and just as the Lord had said, the boys were very different. Esau, the older, liked to travel away from home. When he wanted something, he wanted it right now. He liked to hunt and often brought his father things from afar, and he was his father's favorite twin. Jacob, on the other hand, liked to stay close to home. He learned how to take care of his father's flocks and herds. He learned to cook. He spent a lot of time with his mother. And, of course, Jacob was his mother's favorite twin. One day, Esau came in from hunting, and he was very hungry, and he smelled something good. Jacob was cooking something good. It might have been lentil stew. Esau stood before his brother and exclaimed, "I'm starving!" Then he demanded, "Let me have some of that." Jacob replied, "Are you really so hungry? Hungry enough to trade me your rights as the firstborn son?" Esau answered, "I'm about to die of hunger. What good will my rights do me then?" So Jacob gave him some bread and some of the food. Esau ate and drank and then got up and left. He did not care about his rights as the firstborn son. All he cared about was how he felt at the moment. And because of that, he gave up something that would have been a blessing for the rest of his life.
A thief in the family. The memory verse is from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 11. It says, "Do not steal. Do not lie. Do not deceive one another." The message is the people and God's family are honest. Have you ever done something you knew you shouldn't do, and when someone asked you about it, you told a lie? How would you feel if you were caught telling a lie? Jacob lied to his father and hurt his whole family. You would have never thought that Jacob and Esau were twins. They looked different. They dressed differently. They even had different interests. They were opposites. Esau liked to hunt, and Jacob loved to stay home and look after the family flocks and herds. Before they were born, God spoke to their mother, Rebekah. He said that the older brother would serve the younger. She didn't know how this would happen, but she believed what God said. Isaac was now old and blind. He decided that it was time for him to give the special blessing to his son. Rebekah reminded him of what God had said. But Esau was Isaac's favorite, and Isaac was determined to give him the blessing. One day, Rebekah overheard Isaac talking to Esau.
"Esau, I am old," she heard Isaac say. "I don't know how long I will live. Take your weapons and hunt some wild game for me. Prepare the kind of tasty food I like and bring it to me. Then I will give you my blessing."
As soon as Esau left, Rebekah called Jacob to her. She told him what was happening. Then she said, "Don't worry, Jacob, I have a plan. Go to the flock and bring me 2 of the best kid goats. I will prepare food just the way your father likes it. Then you can take it to him and get the blessing." Jacob replied, "But he will know the difference. Esau is hairy and I am not. Father would know I was tricking him. He would curse me rather than bless me."
"If anyone should be cursed, it will be me," his mother responded. "Just go and do as I tell you."
Rebekah gave Jacob some of Esau's clothes, and Jacob put them on. She also covered his hands and neck with goat skins. Then Jacob went to Isaac with the food Rebekah had prepared. Isaac heard Jacob entering the room.
"Who is it?" he asked.
"Esau, your firstborn," lied Jacob. "I have done as you told me, father. Set up and taste this good food and give me the blessing."
"How did you find the game so quickly?" asked Isaac.
"God helped me," lied Jacob once again.
Then Isaac said,
"Come close so I can touch you. You sound like Jacob, but your hands, they feel like Esau. Are you really Esau?"
"Yes, father," Jacob lied again.
"Then come and give me some of the food to eat," said Isaac.
Jacob brought the meal to Isaac, and Isaac ate. Then Isaac said to Jacob,
"Come here, my son, and kiss me."
Jacob went to his father and kissed him.
"Ah,"
Isaac said, satisfied at last.
"These smell of the field."
And so that was that Isaac blessed Jacob. Jacob hurried away. He had just left when Esau entered his father's tent.
"Here is the food you asked for, father," announced Esau.
Isaac trembled, and in a shaking voice he asked, "Who are you?"
"I am Esau, your firstborn," replied Esau.
Then Isaac said,
"Who was just here? Was it Jacob?"
Isaac knew then what had happened. He turned to Esau and sadly said,
"I blessed him. I blessed your brother Jacob."
Esau was furious.
"Can't you bless me as well? Jacob cheated me out of my inheritance. Now he has cheated me out of your blessing. Can't you give me anything?"
Isaac sadly shook his head.
"The blessing has been given. I cannot take it away."
Esau muttered as he left his father's tent,
"When my father dies, I will get what is mine."
Jacob knew he had done wrong, and he was sorry. He felt sad. His lies had caused problems for everyone. He should have waited. God had made a promise. He would not have needed Jacob's help or Rebecca's help either. What would happen now?
Angels on a Ladder. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 28, verse 15. It says, "I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go." Today's message is, "I belong to God's family no matter what happens." Have you ever felt lonely, really alone? Or felt that there was no one you could talk to? That's how Jacob felt when he had to leave home. Then God shared a special time with him. After that, Jacob never felt lonely. Isaac and Rebecca's twins, Esau and Jacob, had never liked each other very much. But now, the situation was much worse. Jacob had tricked their father into giving him a special blessing. It was a blessing that Esau should have received. Esau was so angry at Jacob that he wanted to kill him. So their mother, Rebekah, decided to send Jacob to his uncle Laban. "Stay with your uncle for a while, Jacob. Give your brother time to cool his anger," she said sadly. Little did she know that she would never see Jacob again. So Jacob started out on the long trip to Laban's home, his mother's brother. His uncle Laban lived a long way from Jacob's parents. It was almost 500 miles through strange and dangerous country. Jacob was all alone, and he was frightened. He had no one to protect him from wild beasts or robbers, and he wasn't used to sleeping on the hard ground. He traveled as fast as he could. He knew he was running for his life. He knew his brother wanted to kill him. In a day or two, Jacob arrived at a special place. His grandfather, Abraham, had once built an altar there to worship God. Jacob was so tired that night, he may not have even known he was in such a special place. He just wrapped up in his blanket and went to sleep with his head on a rock. That night, Jacob had an unusual dream. Not an ordinary dream at all, but a special dream from God. In his dream, Jacob saw a huge ladder or staircase. It reached all the way from the earth to heaven. Jacob saw angels going up and down the ladder. God spoke to him,
"I am the Lord, the God of Abraham and Isaac. I will be with you and protect you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you."
Jacob sat up and looked around. "The Lord is here," he exclaimed. "He is in this place, and I didn't know it." Jacob got up early the next morning. The stars were just beginning to fade away,
and the sun was just beginning to light the eastern sky. Jacob wanted to do something to mark this special place. The Lord himself had spoken to him there. So he used the stone he had used for a pillow and set it upright in the ground. He poured oil all over it and dedicated it to God. And then he named this special place Bethel, the house of God. So Jacob continued on his journey. He was no longer afraid of his brother. He was not afraid of wild beasts or robbers. He knew for sure that the Lord was with him. The Lord was protecting him. God had told him so. Jacob's journey ends. The memory verse is from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 6. It says, "We show that we are servants of God by our kindness." Today's message is being kind at home helps us learn how to serve others. Can you think of a time where someone in your family helped you without being asked? What did they do for you? Did their kindness surprise you? Our story this week reminds us of something important. We learn how to serve others by being kind at home. It was morning, and Jacob woke up to continue his long journey to Haran. He had left his home because his brother was very angry with him. Jacob had tricked his father and had gotten a special blessing that should have gone to his brother. Because of this, his mom thought it was a good idea for him to go and stay with her brother Laban for a while. She also hoped that Jacob would find a wife there. The night before, while he had slept with a stone for his pillow, he had a dream. He had dreamed that he had seen a ladder and angels going up and down the ladder. Then God had spoken to him and promised to be with him. Jacob worshiped God when he woke up and had promised that God would be his God. Now he was ready to continue his journey. It was a long journey, about 450 miles altogether. It would take many, many weeks of walking. Finally, after many days and nights of traveling, Jacob neared the city of Haran. He hoped to find his mother's family there. His journey was almost over, and he was so glad. On the outskirts of Haran, Jacob saw a well. It was about noon, and three flocks of sheep were gathered there. "Why are these flocks at the well in the middle of the day?" he wondered. This well was different from those near Jacob's home. He saw that a huge stone covered the well's opening. There were no troughs from which the sheep could drink. Jacob approached the well and spoke to the shepherds gathered there.
"My brothers, where are you from?"
he asked.
"We are from Haran," one shepherd replied. "Do you know a man named Laban who lives there?"
Jacob questioned.
"Yes, we know him,"
the shepherds answered. Then Jacob asked,
"Is he well?"
"Yes, he is," replied one of the shepherds. "In fact, here comes his daughter Rachel with some of his sheep. She is a shepherdess." The man pointed to a young woman coming toward them. Jacob looked and saw Rachel coming to the well. She was leading a flock of sheep, but she was still quite some distance away. Jacob continued talking with the shepherds.
"Tell me, why don't you water your sheep and take them back to the pasture?"
he asked.
"There is still a lot of daylight left."
"We can't," they replied.
"It is our custom to wait until all the flocks are gathered. When they are all here, we remove the big stone from the well. Then all the animals drink, and we cover the well again."
While Jacob and the shepherds talked together, Rachel and her sheep arrived.
Jacob went over to the well. He kindly rolled the heavy stone away from the opening. Then he led his uncle Laban's sheep to the water and cared for them. He spoke kindly to Rachel. "I am Jacob, and I am one of your relatives. I have come a long way to meet your family. Your father's sister, Rebecca, is my mother." He was so glad to finally meet a relative that he began to cry. His long journey was over. He was with family again.
"Please, wait right here," Rachel exclaimed. "I want to let my father know that you are here."
Then she turned quickly and ran toward home. An excited Rachel told her father about Jacob. Laban was amazed that Jacob had come so far. He hurried back to the well with her.
"How wonderful to meet you, Jacob," he exclaimed.
He hugged his nephew and kissed his cheeks, as that was their custom.
"We're so glad you're here. Come, let's go home so we can visit."
Laban led the way. Soon they reached Laban's home. There Jacob told his uncle about the family he had left behind. He talked about his mother, Rebecca, and how she had sent Jacob to Laban. And Uncle Laban welcomed his nephew Jacob into his home. Soon Jacob became a part of Laban's family. Yes, Jacob helped Rachel by removing the heavy stone from the well, and he helped her by watering the sheep. No one had to ask him to help. He showed courtesy and kindness to Rachel. Can you help others without being asked? By being kind to your own family, you learn to serve others. What will you do to serve others this week? Who cheated? The memory verse is from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4. It says, "Love is patient. Love is kind." Today's message is God helps us serve others faithfully and patiently. Have you ever worked hard and long for someone you love? Maybe it was helping your dad stack wood or repair the house. Or maybe you helped your mom in the garden all day. You were glad when it was over, but because you loved that person, it was worth it. Jacob had been at Laban's house for a month. One day Laban said,
"Jacob, you are my relative. It doesn't seem right for you to keep working for me without pay. Tell me, what wages would you like?"
Jacob was glad to be at his uncle's house. He didn't mind the work, and he also had been admiring Uncle Laban's youngest daughter, Rachel. "Uncle Laban, what I would really like is to marry Rachel. I will work 7 years for you if you will let Rachel become my wife." Laban agreed.
"That sounds like a fine arrangement to me.
Yes, stay here and work for me." In those days, a man gave money to the father of the woman he wanted to marry. After the wedding, the father was to give the money to his daughter. It became her own to keep. Some men didn't have money for the bride price, or dowry, as it was called. So if the father agreed, the man could work for him for a certain amount of time. And that's what Jacob had to do. So Jacob began 7 years of work to make Rachel his wife. Day after day, he faithfully and patiently did all that Laban asked. And the time seemed to pass quickly because of his love for Rachel. Finally, the 7 years were up. It was time to make Rachel his bride. But Laban was not honest or fair with Jacob. He liked having Jacob work without pay. He knew that Jacob worked hard without complaining.
it was clear that God was helping Jacob to become a faithful worker, and he didn't cost Laban anything. So Laban decided to do something very wrong. He would trick Jacob to get more free labor from him. In those days, the bride wore a heavy veil during the wedding celebration. No one was to see her face. That night, Jacob took his veiled bride to his tent. He couldn't see that it was Leah, not Rachel. In the morning, Jacob made a terrible discovery. He had married the wrong sister. He was shocked and angry. How could his uncle have done such a thing? "Uncle Laban, why have you done this?" Jacob asked. "I worked hard for you so I could marry Rachel. Why did you trick me?"
"It is our custom," Laban lied, "for the older sister to marry before the younger. But I'll make a bargain with you. You may also marry Rachel if you work for me for another 7 years."
In those days, in that country, many men had more than one wife. So at the end of the week of Leah's wedding celebration, Jacob and Rachel were also married. Then Jacob began to work 7 more years for Laban. Jacob worked without pay for 14 years, a long time, to marry Rachel. Patiently, he served Laban all that time. He truly believed that having Rachel for his wife was worth it, and God helped him to serve faithfully, even when the work was hard. When we really love someone, we will serve faithfully and with patience, too. Running Away Again. The memory verse is from Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. It says, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart." Today's message is loving service is done well, even without a reward. Have you ever eaten in a restaurant with your family? If the service was good, did your family leave a reward or a tip for the person who waited on you? Did that person expect a reward or a tip? When you help someone, do you think about getting a reward? 20 years had gone by since Jacob had left his home and family. 20 years he had worked for his uncle Laban. By this time, Jacob had 10 sons and at least 1 daughter. After Joseph had been born, Jacob had asked Laban to let him return to Canaan. But Laban had begged him to stay.
"Please stay," Laban had pleaded. "I know that the Lord has blessed me because of you."
So Jacob had agreed to stay, and Laban had agreed to pay Jacob for his work. All the spotted, speckled, and dark-colored sheep or goats would belong to Jacob. Since that time, many animals had been added to Jacob's flock. Jacob was now a wealthy man. Laban's sons were not happy about this. Jacob knew that they believed his flocks should belong to them. And Jacob also knew that Laban's attitude towards him was not what it had been. So when the Lord told Jacob, "Go back to the land of your fathers," Jacob knew it was time to leave. Without a word to Laban, he gathered his wives, his children, and his flocks and started for Canaan. After 3 days, Laban learned that Jacob was gone. Laban started after him. 7 days later, Laban caught up with Jacob. That night, God spoke to Laban. The next day, Jacob watched Laban and his men. He wrinkled his forehead with concern as they drew nearer.
he knew that Laban would not be happy with him.
"Why did you run away without telling me?" shouted Laban. "You didn't even let me kiss my grandchildren and my daughters goodbye. You know it is in my power to harm you. But last night God told me not to say anything to you, good or bad."
Jacob answered, "I left without telling you because I thought you might try to take my wives and children away."
"Uncle Laban," Jacob continued, "I have been a faithful worker for you for 20 years. During that time, I was careful to take good care of your animals. I didn't complain about my work, whether it was blistering hot or freezing cold. I worked 14 years to pay my debt to you for your daughters. And these past 6 years, I have worked to earn my animals. During that time, you changed my pay 10 times. But God was with me. You would have sent me away empty-handed, but God knows how hard I've worked for you, and that is why he talked to you last night."
"Jacob, in a way, everything you have is from me," Laban spoke sharply. "These are my daughters and my grandchildren. The animals you have came from my flocks, but it wouldn't be right for me to keep my daughters and their children."
Laban's voice was kinder now.
"Let's make a peaceful agreement," he offered.
Jacob agreed. So both families gathered some stones into a big heap.
"These stones are a witness between us," said Laban. "I will not go past this pile of stones to harm you, and you will not pass it to harm me."
Jacob repeated the promise.
"I will not harm you, and you will not harm me."
Then the two men and their families shared a meal together. Early the next morning, Laban kissed his daughters and grandchildren. Then Laban returned home, and Jacob and his family traveled on toward Canaan. For many years, people called that place Mizpah, a place of blessing. For it was there that Laban said to Jacob, "May the Lord keep watch between you and me when we are away from each other." Home at last. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 33, verse 11. It says, "God has been gracious to me, and I have all I need." Today's message is we serve God when we share his blessings with others. Enrique offered Andy half of his sandwich. Earlier that morning, Andy had laughed at how Enrique had pronounced a certain word. Enrique's feelings had been hurt, but he wanted to show Andy that he forgave him and still wanted them to be friends. Sharing is a way to show someone how we feel about them. In the story today, Jacob shared with Esau. Jacob was returning to his homeland. God had told him to, but he was a little nervous. Jacob remembered how he had tricked Esau into selling him his birthright. He remembered how he had tricked their father into giving him the special blessing that should have been Esau's. Would Esau still be angry with him? Jacob turned to God for help, and God sent angels to be with him. Jacob sent messengers to greet Esau. "This is what you are to say to my master Esau," he directed. "Your servant Jacob says." And then he told them the rest of the message. He also told them that they were to call Esau, "My Lord Esau." This would tell Esau that Jacob did not claim any inheritance. But the messengers returned with frightening news. Esau was approaching with 400 men.
Would Esau attack? Jacob wondered. Again, Jacob turned to God. Then Jacob sent Esau a message and many animals as gifts. He directed his messenger to say, "Your servant Jacob is coming behind us." That night, Jacob sent his family and all his possessions across a stream called Jabbok, but he stayed behind by himself, and there he met God. All night, he wrestled with an angel. Then he begged for a blessing and received it. The next day, Jacob saw Esau and his 400 men coming. Quickly, Jacob divided his family. He put the children with their mothers. Then he went to the front of the group. While still a long way from Esau, Jacob bowed low to the ground. Then he walked on and bowed again. Jacob did this 7 times until they were very close. But when Esau saw Jacob, he ran to him. He threw his arms around him, and they both began to cry. Jacob must have felt such relief. After a little while, Esau asked, "Who are all these people with you?" "This is the family God has given me," Jacob told him. After the introductions, Esau asked, "What about all that you sent before you? What does that mean?" Jacob replied, "These are my presents to you, my brother. I want you to know that I need your mercy and forgiveness."
"I already have plenty, Jacob. Keep what is yours," Esau responded graciously.
But Jacob said, "No, please accept these gifts. It will show me that you have truly forgiven me. God has been good to me, and I have all I need." Esau finally accepted the gifts. Then he said,
"Let us be on our way. I'll travel with you."
"Thank you, Esau," Jacob replied gratefully. "But we really need to travel much slower than you do. We have so many children and young animals."
"Then let me leave some of my men with you," Esau responded.
"No, thank you," said Jacob. "I only want to please you, my master." Esau left then and went on ahead. Jacob, with his large family and flocks, followed slowly. Finally, they reached Shechem in the land of Canaan, Jacob's homeland. There, Jacob purchased land. After 20 years, he would finally have a home, a place for his family and his flocks. Even though he was anxious to reach Canaan, Jacob put his family's needs first. When we truly serve others, we will be considerate of their needs too. Together again. The message is from Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. It says, "Let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." Today's message is God Helps Me Serve My Family. When his parents were sick, Ethan stepped up and took care of his little brother so his parents could rest a while. Ethan served meals to his little brother and helped him clean up. Do you help to serve others in your family? Today's story is about what Joseph did for his family. After being away for many years, Father Jacob had returned to Canaan with his wives and 12 sons. Joseph was the second youngest and his father's favorite. Because of this, his older brothers hated him and decided to sell him to slave traders going to Egypt. In Egypt, Joseph had remained faithful to God even when bad things had happened to him. Eventually, God had helped him to become the governor. When a famine came on all the land, Jacob sent his 10 sons to Egypt for food. Joseph was in charge of the food, but Joseph's brothers did not know who he was
yet Joseph knew them and finally made himself known. He told them that he had forgiven them for selling him into slavery. He promised to take care of the entire family, and now the brothers were on their way back to Canaan with the good news. What a grand trip it was! They had carts loaded with food. They had new clothes and money that Joseph had given them. They had many donkeys loaded with presents for their father. And they had Pharaoh's special invitation to come and live in Egypt. He had promised that their families would have food to eat during the rest of the famine. When they got home, their father, Jacob, could not believe the news. His favorite son, Joseph, was alive? Joseph was not dead as he believed all those years? "Are you sure?" he asked his sons over and over. "Are you sure Joseph is alive, and you say he is the governor of Egypt? Tell me again. Tell me again." Finally, Jacob and his family set out for Egypt. Jacob, his children, his in-laws, his grandchildren, everybody went. Some rode comfortably in the carts that Pharaoh had provided for them. Jacob's sons rode beside the carts on Pharaoh's plump donkeys. It was a long journey, but they had plenty of food for the trip. Jacob's heart sang the whole way. He was really, truly going to see his son Joseph once again. In Joseph's home, his servants brought him the good news. "Your family is almost here," they announced. "Hurry, get my chariot ready," Joseph ordered. He drove as fast as his horses could gallop to meet his father. When he got to where he was, Joseph ran to Jacob and hugged him. Together, they cried for joy. Soon after, Joseph took five of his brothers to the palace to meet Pharaoh.
"What is your occupation?" Pharaoh asked them.
"We are shepherds," the brothers answered.
"Your brothers may live in Goshen," Pharaoh told Joseph. "It is the best of my land, and I will also hire your brothers to take care of my cattle, if they wish."
Joseph took his father to meet Pharaoh, too. Then Jacob, the great man of God, blessed Pharaoh, the mighty king of Egypt. After that, Jacob lived with his family in Egypt for 17 years. Then he died. He was 147 years old. Now Joseph's brothers began to worry. Now that their father was dead, what would Joseph do? Would he finally get even with them for the terrible thing they had done? They decided to send Joseph a message.
"Before our father died, he said he wanted you to forgive us for the evil thing we did to you."
"You meant to harm me," Joseph replied, "but God meant it for good. He made it possible for me to help all of you." How has God made it possible for you to serve your family? You may never be an officer in your country's government. You may never have to save your family from starvation, but you are part of a family. What can you do now to help and show love to the people you live with? What can you do to serve your church family also? The Nighttime Visitor. The memory verse is from 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. It says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are." Today's message is God's love changes us. When a mother says she's going to change the baby, what does she mean? How is she going to change it? Into what? You know what she means. But what did Jesus mean when he said, "You must be born again"? Crickets chirped in the grass. Nighttime birds sang. Quietly, Nicodemus walked toward the place where he had heard he could find Jesus. He didn't want anyone else to see him talking to Jesus. When he found Jesus, Nicodemus said, "Teacher, we know you came from God. Your miracles tell everybody so." Jesus may have smiled in the darkness. He knew Nicodemus really wanted to believe in him. But Nicodemus was an important Pharisee, a member of the Jewish council. He came to Jesus late at night because he didn't want the other Pharisees to know. Nicodemus knew that Jesus was a teacher sent from God, but he wasn't sure that Jesus could really be God's son. Jesus looked steadily at him.
"Nicodemus," he said, "miracles are not the most important thing. Unless you are born again, you will not see God's kingdom." "Born again? What does that mean? I can't go back inside of my mother. I'm a grown man," Nicodemus exclaimed. "You're right, my friend," Jesus answered, "but I'm not talking about being born physically. I'm talking about being born spiritually. Truthfully, Nicodemus, unless you are reborn by God's Holy Spirit, you can't be part of God's kingdom."
"I don't understand," Nicodemus said thoughtfully.
"Think about the wind for a moment," Jesus replied. "You can't see the wind itself, but you can see what happens when the wind blows. You can see the treetops sway and hear the rustling of the leaves. When the Holy Spirit comes into a person's life, it's like that. You can't see inside a person's heart, their mind, but you can see what happens in their life because their life is new and clean. Their life is changed."
It was quiet as Nicodemus thought about what Jesus was saying.
"Nicodemus, your physical life came from your parents," Jesus continued. "But a person's spiritual life comes from the Holy Spirit. When a person chooses to let God come into his or her life, God helps them change their sinful mind and gives the person a brand new one. That's being born again." "Nicodemus, I have good news for you. God loves the world so much that he sent his only son here to save the world. When someone believes in him, God can give them that brand new life. And that new life means you are born again. And those born again will receive the gift of eternal life."
Nicodemus learned something that night that everyone must learn. Jesus loves us so much. He is ready right now to take our sinful hearts and lives and give us new ones. Will you let him give you that new, clean heart today? Will you be born again? Will you take the gift of eternal life that he wants to give you? You might want to say something like this to Jesus. "Dear Jesus, thank you for loving me. My life is sinful. Right now, I want to give it to you. I ask you to give me a new, clean heart and mind instead. Change my life to be more like yours. Thank you for your gift of eternal life. I love you, Jesus. Amen."
Walking on Water. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 18, verse 27. It says, "What is impossible with man is possible with God." Today's message is, by keeping our eyes on Jesus, we are saved. Do you know how to swim? Can you stay on top of the water? A long time ago, Jesus and Peter were both on top of the water, but they weren't swimming. Let's find out what happened.
the disciples were in a boat together, sailing across the Sea of Galilee. They had spent the day with Jesus and had seen him do something amazing. He had taken 5 loaves and 2 fish and used it to feed more than 5,000 people. How they wished Jesus would let the people crown him king. But at the end of the day, Jesus had sent the people home, and to the disciples he said, "Go ahead, go across the lake in the boat." Then Jesus had gone to a quiet place to pray. Out on the lake, dark clouds began to gather. The wind whipped angry waves against the fishing boat. The experienced fishermen strained at the oars. They pulled harder and harder, but the storm was very strong. The storm continued raging through the night. The wind pushed the waves higher and higher. By now, the disciples were a considerable distance from the shore. Shortly before morning, but while it was still dark, Jesus saw them way out on the lake and decided to go to them. Suddenly, the disciples saw someone coming across the water toward them. They cried out in fear. "It's a ghost!" they shouted. It frightened them to see a person coming toward them walking over the waves as if they were on solid ground. "Don't be afraid," a familiar voice called. "It is I, Jesus." Then Peter called out, "If it's really you, Lord, tell me to come to you on the water." "Come." Jesus beckoned toward his eager and sometimes reckless disciple. Looking at Jesus, Peter climbed out of the boat and began walking along the top of the water. He took several steps. Then he turned his eyes away from Jesus and looked back at the disciples. He may have been thinking, "Hey, look at me. Can you believe it?" As he started to turn back toward Jesus, he saw the huge waves. He felt the strong winds. He became afraid, and he started to sink. Instantly, Peter's courage was gone. "Lord," he shouted, "save me." Even as Peter began to sink, the strong arm of Jesus reached out to him. Jesus grasped hold of his outstretched hand and lifted him up. "You of little faith," Jesus said, "why did you doubt?" Jesus meant that Peter needed only to keep his eyes on him. Peter needed to keep believing that Jesus had the power to save him. Jesus put his arm around Peter, and they climbed into the boat. Once Jesus was in the boat, the wind calmed and the waves relaxed, and the little fishing boat sailed quietly to the other side of the lake. Today, Jesus says to us, "Just keep your eyes on me. I'm here to rescue you. You can't do it by yourself, but don't worry. I can save you. Just keep trusting me." From sorrow to joy. The memory verse is from Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 13. It says, "I will turn their mourning into gladness. I will give them comfort and joy instead of sorrow." Today's message is Jesus gives his love and grace freely. Twyla was at the store and saw some candy on the counter. She took it without paying for it because she thought it was free. Her dad saw what had happened and asked her to do the right thing and pay for the candy. We'd all like something good for free, wouldn't we? Well, did you know that Jesus gives his love and grace freely? And those are better than candy. Jesus and his friends talked and laughed together as they walked along a dusty road. The little mountain village of Nain lay before them. The road was rough and rocky in places as it led up to the village. Along the way, Jesus had been telling people about God's love for them, and he had been healing the sick that were brought his way. Nearing Nain, the happy group were met by a sad sight leaving the city gate. As the procession came closer, Jesus and his friends learned that a widow had lost her only son. Jesus looked at the heartbroken mother. He felt her sadness and sorrow as she wept for her son. He knew that she had lost her husband to death sometime before. Her son had been the only one to take care of his mother, but now she had no one. She would probably be left penniless and homeless. The woman walked on weeping and did not notice Jesus. He came close to her and spoke gently. "Don't cry," he said. Then he turned to the open coffin carrying her son. The men carrying the coffin stopped when Jesus put his hand on it. Everyone waited to see what would happen next. Jesus's friends gathered around. Those in the funeral procession stood quietly nearby. What would Jesus do? They probably wondered. Jesus looked at the still body. Then he said, "Young man, I tell you, get up." Suddenly, the widow's son sat up and began to talk. The news about Jesus breaking up a funeral traveled far and wide. People had never heard of such a thing. This was the first time that Jesus, while on earth, brought someone back to life. Those who watched were amazed. They began to praise God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us." The news about Jesus breaking up a funeral traveled far and wide. People had never heard of such a thing. This was the first time that Jesus, while on earth, brought someone back to life. But those who were there and saw it were quick to tell others. Jesus has the same love for us that he showed the widow and her son. She didn't ask for help from Jesus. Jesus saw her tears and her sorrow. His love for her and concern for her suffering caused him to perform this miracle. Truly, Jesus turned her sorrow into joy. Jesus can turn our sorrow into joy too. He loves every one of us and wants us to be happy. And he will turn many sorrows into joy when he comes again. At that time, he will bring those from the grave who gave their hearts to him before they died. What a day of joy that will be! Mothers, fathers, boys, and girls will be together again to live with Jesus forever. The Parable of the Great Feast. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 14, verse 15. It says, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." Today's message is Jesus invites us to be with him in heaven. Jesus told a story once about someone who had prepared a great feast. When the feast was ready, he sent to call the guests. Find out what happened and what it could mean for us. Once, Jesus and his disciples were having a meal at someone's house, and Jesus told this story. "A man gave a big banquet and invited many people," Jesus began. "When it was time to eat, the man sent his servant to tell the guests, 'Come, everything is ready.' But all the guests said that they could not come. Each man made an excuse. The first one said, 'I have just bought a land, and I must go look at it. Please excuse me.' Another man said, 'I have just bought 5 pairs of oxen. I must go try them. Please excuse me.' A third man said, 'I just got married. I can't come.'
So the servant returned. He told his master what had happened. Then the master became angry and said, "Go at once into the streets and the alleys of the town. Bring in the poor, the cripple, the blind, and the lame." Later the servant said to him, "Master, I did what you told me to do, but we still have places for more people." The master said to the servant, "Go out into the roads and country lanes. Tell the people there to come. I want my house to be full. None of those men that I invited first will ever eat with me." Jesus was talking about himself in this parable. He is like the man who planned the party and invited many people. Jesus has invited everyone to accept his salvation, which leads to eternal life. And he's giving you an invitation. Many people in the story had excuses for not coming to the party. They let other things become more important than being with their friend. They weren't really true friends at all. Because they were too busy with things, they turned down the invitation and missed the great feast. In this parable, the invitation to the banquet is Jesus' invitation for us to accept his salvation. Accepting salvation means that we ask Jesus to forgive our sins and choose to do the things he wants us to do. We have a choice. We can decide to accept his invitation or to let other things become more important in our lives. How about you? Right now, will you say yes to the invitation Jesus has given you? Do you want to be with him in heaven and experience the joy of being in his presence forever? Healing at the Pool of Bethesda. The memory verse is from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. It says, "For it is by grace that you have been saved, through faith. It is the gift of God." Today's message is Jesus sees our needs and helps us. Have you ever wanted something very much and had to wait a long time for it? Maybe you wanted a new toy or a watch, or maybe you were sick for a long time and wanted to get well quickly. The man in our story today knew what it was to want something very badly and to have to wait a long time for it. Jesus has come to Jerusalem to attend a feast. Soon he finds himself near a pool, the Pool of Bethesda. 5 beautiful covered porches surround the pool. This is the kind of place that should be peaceful. It should be surrounded with lush green plants and colorful flowers. But it is a place of sickness and misery. All around the pool, people are struggling. Sick people lie in all angles or sit hunched over. So many people. Jesus stops. He looks around. He sees the blind, the deaf, the crippled. He sees some with stomach problems and skin diseases. Some suffer from mental health problems. His heart goes out to the elderly, the children, and all those of ages in between. All are here, hoping for a miracle. The people wait for the water in the pool to move. Many believe it will be stirred by an angel, and whoever is first in the water afterward will be healed. Jesus knows that isn't true. It is a false hope, but the people wait and watch. And when the ripples appear, the eager people rush forward. Desperate for healing, they trample the smaller or weaker. Jesus looks over this crowd of sick people, and he has compassion on them. He wants to heal all of them.
He knows some of the Jewish leaders would be angry if he healed the sick today. Do you know why? It's because it was the Sabbath. They would even try to kill him, but his time has not yet come. His work on earth is not finished. Jesus knows each person's name and their sickness. He especially notices one man who has been crippled for 38 years. Jesus knows that this man is sad. He is lonely, and he feels that he is not worthy of God's mercy. Quietly, Jesus kneels beside him and bends over to see his face. Tenderly, he asks, "Do you want to be healed?" Hope jumps in the man's heart. Of course he wants to be healed. Doesn't everyone hear? He doesn't know who Jesus is. He doesn't know that Jesus can heal him. He believes his only hope is to get into that water. So he tells Jesus, "Sir, I don't have anyone to help me. I can't get into the pool fast enough. When I try, someone always gets in before me." Jesus doesn't ask the man to believe in him. He doesn't even tell the man who he is. He knows the man doesn't feel worthy of God's love, but Jesus wants to pour his grace out on this man. So he says to the man, "Get up, pick up your bed and walk." The man does not hesitate. He obeys. He wants to be made well. Nerves and muscles that haven't been useful for years are brought to life. The man jumps up. He rolls his rug and blanket. Then he looks around for the one who just healed him. But Jesus has slipped away into the crowd. Later, Jesus meets the man in the temple. The man is overjoyed, and he tells everyone he meets the good news about Jesus. That day, Jesus healed a man's body. Jesus's healing grace also brought him back to God. With love, Jesus says to us, "Will you be healed?" He wants us to be healthy in body and spirit. He wants to pour out his grace on us too. Will you accept him today and let him be your savior too? Angel Heralds. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 2, verse 10. It says, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people." Today's message is we worship God when we sing joyful songs of praise. Do you know why many people celebrate Christmas? What do you think it was like when Jesus was born? We don't know what it was like, but we do know heaven rejoiced, so much so that the angels came to sing. Perhaps it happened like this. It's time. The time has finally come. Jesus is born. One excited angel bubbled with joy. "But do you see? Hardly anyone is paying attention," added another. "The priests in the temple continue to sacrifice the lambs," said another. "But I don't think they know what that means." "I wish we could tell them that Jesus has been born," added another angel. "I just want to shout, 'We have good news for you. Your Savior has been born.'" The angel choir knew what they would sing. They were ready to tell the world about Jesus. It was almost time for their special concert. Tonight they would sing, and all the world would remember it for years to come. Jesus, the Son of God, had come to this sin-filled planet to be born as a baby. They would tell the world. The angels had been watching people on earth. They saw the priests in the temple. Those men were supposed to know about the Savior's birth. Prophets had told about it for years.
But those who studied their prophecies weren't even thinking about it. The greatest event that would ever take place on Earth had taken place, yet only a few people were even looking at it. No, most people in the temple didn't remember, or maybe they just didn't care. But a few people who lived near Bethlehem cared. At that very time, a few shepherds were gathered on a hillside watching their sheep. They were among the few who knew it was time for the Savior to come. Soon the command rang out, and the angels hurried to take their places. In the middle of the night, Gabriel led them to the skies above Bethlehem. There they waited while Gabriel spoke to the shepherds. Then the angel choir would sing. Suddenly, God's glory lit up the night. The shepherds in the fields were terrified. "Don't be afraid," Gabriel announced. "I have good news. This very day, your Savior has been born. You'll find him in Bethlehem, wrapped in soft cloths and lying in a manger." Immediately, the sky was filled with shining angels. The angel choir joined Gabriel, filling the night with the most glorious music ever heard. "Glory to our God! Glory to our God! The highest glory to him! Peace has come to earth. God has sent his best gift to humanity." On and on they sang as they slowly went back toward the heavens. Still stunned, the astonished shepherds watched. Filled with awe, one shepherd finally found his voice.
"What are we waiting for?" he asked. "Let's go to Bethlehem to see this babe the Lord has sent."
And they soon left that hillside to go in search of the Savior of the world, a baby lying in a manger. Do you know that the angels are still singing the glory song today? Our hearts can overflow with that joy of worshiping Jesus too. Like the angels, we can worship God in song. The shepherds worship Jesus. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 2, verse 14. It says, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." Today's message is we worship the God who guides us. When you receive a gift, do you thank the person who gave it to you? I hope you do. Thanking people for their gifts is very important. Still amazed at what they had seen in the middle of the night, the wide-awake shepherds chattered among themselves. The angel choir that had come to them in the night was gone now. What a message the angel had delivered! "Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Could it be true? Would they find the Messiah, their Savior, in the nearby city? Bethlehem was known as the city of David, and it was a short distance from the hillside where the shepherds watched their sheep. But why would the Messiah be lying in a manger? That's what the angel had said. A manger? How could that be? Could the Messiah, the Savior of the world, have come to them as a baby? They knew that newborn babies were wrapped in soft pieces of cloth to keep them warm and dry. But babies were kept at home, in a house. It seemed so strange.
"Let us go to Bethlehem and see this for ourselves," said one of the shepherds.
"The Lord has sent this message to us," said another.
"These were angels, I'm sure of it," called out another. "I believe we should go too."
So it was that deep in the night the shepherds rushed off to Bethlehem. There, in a stable near an inn where people slept the night away, they found what they were looking for. a baby wrapped in soft cloths lying in a manger. How did they find the stable where the baby had been born? Surely God guided them to that place. And once they were there, they told the baby's parents of the angel's visit and the beautiful angel choir who sang those words of praise. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men. Together, in silence and awe, the shepherds knelt around the manger. There, they worshipped their Savior as the baby's parents looked on. All too soon, the shepherds had to return to their sheep. Filled with joy, they just had to tell others. As they left the city, they could not keep the good news to themselves. And they spread the word to all they met. Glorifying and praising God, they spoke in awe of the angel's visit. They told of the babe in the manger and of the God who sent the message to them. Joseph and Mary were pleased that the shepherds had come. They had gladly invited them inside and listened to their story. They too were amazed at all that had happened. Surely God had guided the shepherds, and he would guide the infant's parents as they cared for the precious gift God had given them. The shepherds would never forget that night. They had seen the fulfillment of the prophecies they had studied for years. And neither would Mary forget. The Bible tells us that she treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart.
Created and produced by Falvo Fowler, this podcast is read by Frenita Buddy Fullwood for Gracelink.net. Animation and artwork by Diogo Godoy. Audio is post-produced by Faith Toh at Studio Elpizo in Singapore. The theme music is by Clayton Kinney. The audio engineer was Maurice Bailey.